Let's talk now to Carlos Conde, Philippine researcher for Human Rights Watch's Asia Division. Hi, Caloy. Welcome back to the program. Thanks for taking our call.
Hi. Hi, Carmina. Thank you for having me.
All right. Now, in your recent dispatch, you wrote about what happened yesterday was justice served, if only partially. And you also wrote, but in today's Philippines, this verdict is a victory nonetheless. Tell us why you wrote that.
Well, it's because as the experience of this country with political violence has always been that political warlords, political leaders, very influential ones, are always getting away with, sometimes murder. And so this is something that, this is a fundamental, crucial issue that hasn't really been tackled in any significant manner in the Philippines. The question of political dynasties, the question of political warlordism. It's even like, it's almost like we're ignoring this and focusing so much on, for instance, press freedom, and which is not bad at all. But I think the fact that nobody is tackling directly the issue of political warlordism, for instance, that they vice the Ampatuans and all the killings that are attributed to them, is, I think, we're like putting our heads in the sun, basically.
And in fact, I was talking to our panel of experts yesterday, and Professor Edmund Tayo also said that, there is a systemic problem that needs to be addressed here, not just feudalism and warlordism, but also the fact that some of the police officers and military officers were acquitted. That bothered him as well. Did that bother you? Because to him, he was saying the very fact that they were at this family's disposal back then really showed how much broken the system was. Care to comment on that?
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, that's part of the whole thing. The Ampatuans would never have been allowed to become to grow so powerful if they didn't have these police officers and these military men and militias at their disposal. And the reason why these people are at this disposal, at their disposal, is because the government at the time, the president, the Arroyo's government, allowed it. So this is all par for the course for the warlords, not just in Maguindanao, but in many other parts of the country. So, certainly the police, the involvement of the police and the soldiers made it much more problematic. But, the Ampatuans being the Ampatuans and the fact that they had so much support from the national government allowed them to amass all of this wealth and put these people under their employ. Now, whether they're civilians or police officers is probably not much of an issue, but the fact that they can do that is rather the issue. And this goes right to the heart of our argument that political warlordism, political dysfunction and all of that are creating many Ampatuans. And again, the fact that they have the armed forces and the police force at their disposal makes the problem even worse.
And there was another discourse that found its way into the discussion yesterday as we all were digesting the verdict. And it's that there was no subsequent investigation into the wealth of the Ampatuans. That throughout the trial, there were reports of copious amounts of money being paid as bribes, allegedly, to victims' families, to witnesses. But yet, there was no subsequent investigation on that. What are your thoughts on that, Caloy?
Well, that's precisely the problem. There were a lot of, there were a lot of reports after the massacre. I mean, about these crates of money and all of this property that they've had. And since then, we haven't, we haven't heard anything about any progress in the investigation. And which is probably not surprising because, what we really wanted, the journalist groups, the families groups, what we really wanted was for all the suspects to be apprehended and brought to court. And it has happened, although, again, partially. But it is an indication of how powerful the Ampatuans are, even though a lot of them are in jail, they managed to still move around like, politically, that is, like nothing happened. Mm-hmm. In August 2018, Zaldi Ampatuan's daughter was wed, had a wedding, and then all, you had a list of all these people, of all these who's who in Philippine politics, as among the principal sponsor. So they never really went away. I mean, the massacre didn't really dismantle the Ampatuan's hold, not just of Maguindanao, but, you know, in some ways, the Philippine political climate. So, again, it does not surprise me that nothing has happened or nothing's been heard about these investigations into the well.
I want to take a moment now and talk about Reynaldo Momay. You know, the quest for justice, for him, it isn't over. It continues. And this is something which made really the verdict bittersweet. Is this something, though, Caloy, that's dispiriting and disheartening for you?
Oh, definitely. I mean, you know, I was covering Ampatuan massacre when I was still writing for the New York Times. And one of the stories I did was on Reynaldo Momay. And I've gotten to know, you know, his family and her daughter, Nenen. And it was an emotional thing to report. And, you know, I mean, in a country where we always grapple with disappearances, with people missing, you know, unheard of since an incident, it is a very, very, you know, disheartening development that the court decided, you know, to set aside the fate of Reynaldo Momay. And that is really, that, as I said in my dispatch, the bitterness that I felt then worsened now because of this. And no matter how we assuage the family of Momay that things are okay, at least there's been some verdict on this case, you know, the fact that the state does not recognize his fate is just disappointing, to say the least.
And this is going to be the very reason why people should not let their guard down, why, despite the verdict, there should be a continuing quest for justice.
Oh, definitely. I think, if anything, this verdict has demonstrated to Filipinos that whether it takes 10 years, whether it takes 20 years, you know, justice will be had. And it's something that while a lot of us are quite impatient with the way things are going in this country in terms of the slow judicial system, in terms of the dysfunctional criminal justice system, there's always some silver lining. And again, regardless of our misgivings about the verdict, how partial it is, how incomplete it is, you know, at least it was a day for justice for the Philippines and for the families of the massacre. And I think we Filipinos should take a moment to draw some lesson from that. Mm. And one of the lessons is that we, you know, eternally vigilant about our freedom.
In your article, you also posed a question, Caloy, and the question goes, is there a chance for another Maguindanao massacre to happen again? And you answered basically your very question, and your answer to that was not conclusive either way. Tell us why.
Well, here's the thing. You know, I personally have developed a healthy amount of cynicism about how things are going in the Philippines, and you cannot fault me or other people for that, because our country has not demonstrated enough. You know, enough good things in terms of seeking justice, in terms of making sure that accountability happens. And so, you know, the skepticism is there. And given the fact that all of these people are still, you know, the Ampatuans, their friends, their networks, and the fact alone that all across the country, not just in Maguindanao, not just in Mindanao, we have political dynasties who unleash the violence and their brutality during elections, it's not comforting. It doesn't inspire, you know, belief that there's nothing, there's no more Ampatuan massacre to happen in the future. So I think it's a well-placed cynicism of how things are going in this country.
Now, despite, you know, this victory being partial as it may be, how do you think this victory will be and should be protected?
Well, it's a question for the government, basically. I mean, look, there are still those 80, you know, or so suspects at large, and, you know, in terms of protecting the families of the victims and the journalists and the witnesses and all of that, it's something that always will bother us, the fact that the government has failed to arrest all of these people. It's not so much that they're acquitted. you know, because what we want to happen is that for due process to take place. But the fact that they are not, you know, almost half of the respondents are not arrested. That is a very, very disconcerting fact, and that is something that you know, drives insecurities and reasons for fear among many of us. So, you know, again, vigilance is key. But ultimately, it's the government's responsibility to make sure that those suspects are arrested and also that people will feel secure in their own environment.
Well, Kaloy, we're going to have to leave it at that. But I do want to wish you and your family a Merry Christmas. And I'd like to thank you for just being available to us throughout the rest of the year, keeping your line open to us and being, you know, available every time we need your insights and your opinion on certain things. Thank you so much, Kaloy, for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you so much, Carmina. And I really appreciate the fact that the ANC has been, you know, covering a lot of the issues that matter to us. And Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to all of you there.
Thanks a lot, Kaloy. Thanks. That was Carlos Conde. He is the Philippine researcher for Human Rights Watch's Asia Division. Thanks again.